There's a book that I'm very fond of with the unforgettable title, The Singing Neanderthals, which I've always thought a very suitable name for a rock group of some sort. But it's a serious essay on the beginnings of human awareness and human speech. The evidence from the skulls of Neanderthals suggests that nasal passages and other things in the brain imply that the Neanderthals sang quite a lot. They discovered and exploited the resonance of the spaces inside their heads. And there's every reason to think that their more aggressive and disagreeable cousins, Homo sapiens, that is us, had much the same history. We sang before we spoke, many people believe. We sang before we spoke. And in the ancient world, thinking about music was most definitely not thinking about some more or less agreeable, decorative extra to human life. Music, whether instrumental or vocal, was a way in which we found ourselves within the harmonies of the universe. Music and mathematics belonged together because the strange rational intervals and proportions between numbers were reflected in sounds and the distance and proportion between them. To sing was very literally and strictly to be in tune with reality. Hardly any surprise, then, that music from the beginning has been part of what people have done when they relate to the sacred. Reading recently about the worship of the Jewish people in the Jerusalem temple, I found a description of what it might have sounded like. And with due respect to everybody involved, it probably wasn't very much like evensong. It would have been extremely noisy. And just like those Greeks who'd been influenced by Pythagoras' mathematical ideas, so the ancient Jews singing in the temple believed that they were taking part in what you might call a rebalancing, a recalibration of the world itself. What happened in the temple was a restoring of relationship between God and the world, between heaven and earth, and part of that was the music. So when Isaiah, in chapter 6 of his prophecy, has the vision of God in the temple, seated on a throne high and lifted up, flanked by the great seraphs who sing holy, holy, holy to one another, we must imagine that that was a kind of projection of what was familiar in the worship of the temple. And the image of those great heavenly powers bellowing to one another antiphonally, that must have reflected the antiphonal bellowing of some early Hebrew soloists to one another in the sanctuary. Now, all of that background, the idea of music as participating in the life of the universe, restoring a balance, actually affecting us, mind, heart, and body, as part of our reconciliation with God, that's a long way from simply regarding music as an extra. And it seems that from very early on in the Christian story, it was taken for granted that music was part of what worship entailed. We sometimes inherit a kind of myth that the very beginnings of Christianity must have been rather like Quaker meetings, quiet and sober and restrained, and when they made any noise, it would be spoken noise, and if spoken noise, then very reasonable and rational noise. It's not quite the impression you have from the New Testament, in fact. Psalms and hymns and spiritual songs are certainly part of what went on in Christian worship from the start. And there's every reason to think that those psalms and hymns and spiritual songs weren't always very carefully composed and were frequently improvised on the spot, with all the pluses and minuses that that might entail. But just a few minutes ago, we were singing the hymn, O Gladsome Light, O Grace, the Fos Ilaron. And that hymn is probably the most ancient surviving text of Christian worship, even before we have texts coming down to us for the Eucharist. We have this text, probably from the second Christian century, sung at the lighting of the lamps. We know that an integral part of what Christians did when they gathered together to worship was to sing. Because, like everybody else in their world, they believed that that was a fundamental form of human expression which could be aligned with the grace and the beauty and the abundance of God and the universe God had made. By the end of the 4th century, music was beginning to be elaborated. People were interested in melody. They believed that the beauty of melody was part of what stirred them to devotion. So much so that St. Augustine, writing right at the end of the 4th century, can utter some warnings which have gone down in Christian history and still have some pertinence. I admit, writes Augustine, I still find some enjoyment in the music of hymns which are alive with your praises when I hear them sung by well-trained, melodious voices. But I do not enjoy it so much that I cannot tear myself away. I can leave it when I wish. The perennial statement of the addict. I can give up any time I want. But if I am not to turn a deaf ear to music, which is the setting for the words which give it life, I must allow it a position of some honour in my heart, and I find it difficult to assign it to its proper place. Sometimes I feel I treat it with more honour than it deserves. When they are sung, these sacred words stir my mind to greater religious fervour and kindle in me a more ardent flame of piety than they would if they were not sung. And he goes on for a page or so, agonising about whether his deep emotion, hearing words sung in church, is getting in the way of the Spirit's freedom truly to relate to the spiritual God. He doesn't resolve it. Typically, of his writing in the Confessions, he leaves us with something to scratch our heads over. Yes, this is wonderful. Yes, this is essential. And yes, we'd better keep it in proportion because it's not everything. And yes, we'd better keep an eye on music that just speaks to our feelings. Or perhaps that's the wrong language. Just before I invite the choir to share their first contribution with us, I want to note something which was said by a very wise and profoundly spiritual teacher, Archbishop Antony of Suroj, Antony Bloom, the great Russian Orthodox leader, who said, as we grow in prayer, we have to set aside emotion in order to get in touch with feeling. What a very strange way of putting it, but a powerful one. Emotion, the inner drama, the turmoil, so fascinating for us. We really love our emotions and we're intrigued by them. But what Archbishop Antony was trying to remind us of is that feeling, sheer awareness, receptivity to what's going on around us, is a bit different. And one of the roles of music in liturgical worship is not to produce emotions, but to open up our feelings, to make us more receptive. As you listen now to Tallis's Salvator Mundi, well, don't ask yourself as you listen, but ask yourself afterwards, does that stir emotion Or does it stir something like feeling? In other words, do you sense that something is flowering in front of you, opening up a space into which you can move? Not making you feel happy or sad or whatever, but perhaps making you feel more there, with more coming to you. So let's listen to Talis. Not about emotion, but about feeling. Entering a larger space. Because that, of course, is what Christian liturgy itself is about. We don't gather to celebrate the liturgy so that we may get new ideas and interesting emotions. We gather so that we may enter into a mystery which is immeasurably greater than we can imagine. And this, of course, is most conspicuously true when we gather for the liturgy of the Eucharist. When we're together at the Mass, we are, as countless Christian teachers have said, in some sense taking part in the life of the Kingdom of Heaven. Eastern Orthodox Christians will always say that the liturgy is heaven on earth. That may sound a very ambitious thing to say about some of the Sunday morning experiences that doubtless many of us have had. Never, I'm sure, at St. Martin's. But it's a serious point. To gather in the Spirit of Christ, to receive the life of Christ in the sacramental bread and wine, is to be transported into another order of reality, into that reconciled climax of all history, which is Christ presenting the redeemed world to his divine Father. To be swept up in that, to be caught up in that great movement, is itself, you might say, a kind of symphonic reality. All of our lives, all of our voices, all of our experience, woven together, drawn together and plaited, as you might say, around that single reality, which is Jesus Christ. So once again, we know that there was singing at the Eucharist from very early on. The familiar tone in which the great Eucharistic prayer is introduced, when we hear the Sursum Corda, The Lord be with you. From all we know, that seems to go back to the very earliest days of the church, and is probably a tone borrowed from the synagogue, because Christians brought into Christian worship a good deal that was familiar in the synagogue, including, of course, the practice of singing the readings from Scripture, or chanting, intoning those readings. Once again, the idea that the obvious way of reading the Bible is just to open a book and read it like this is a rather modern and a rather eccentric one. Ask any Muslim, any Jew, or any Christian east of Egypt. Or indeed, east of probably Carthage in the ancient world. So the Eucharist becomes a focus for all kinds of music. The routine, bread and butter elements of it, the litanies, the chanting of prayer and invocation punctuated by the great cry, Lord have mercy, as you still find, of course, in all the Eastern Christian liturgies, but also the ordinary of the Mass, the regular pieces of hymnody embodied week after week in the Mass alongside the seasonal changes and the routine litanies. The Kyrie, the Lord have mercy at the beginning, the Gloria, glory be to God on high. The Sanctus and Benedictus, when we affirm that we are indeed part of the heavenly reality of music, the Agnus Dei. And by the later Middle Ages, of course, people were beginning to bring settings of these elements of the Mass together into what we now know as a musical Mass. By the time you get to Beethoven's Missa Solemnis, you're in a rather different world, but more of that shortly. Initially, those settings, more and more developed and beautiful as the Middle Ages go on, are simply part of that acknowledgement that what we're doing in the Eucharist is, once again, a musical enterprise. Our voices being made one in Christ. The proportion and beauty and harmony of the music, making us physically participate, because singing is a physical thing, physically participate in the good order, the wisdom, the fruitful wisdom of the whole created universe. The next piece we're going to listen to is from Monteverdi's Messa di Cappella from the 17th century. We're well down the road by this time to musical masses, that is, deliberately composed series of settings of the ordinary of the Mass. And we're just on the cusp in this period of that style developing into something slightly different from its original intention. I noted in one study of church music the statement that such and such a piece was written to cover the actions of the priest at certain points. In other words, there was a lot going on at the altar, and it was rather boring for the congregation, so you had to fill in the space somehow with music. And that suggests a slightly skew-whiff notion of what the liturgy really is, because it's not just a performance in which there are gaps that have to be covered. The whole thing needs to be integrated. Up until, broadly, the 17th century, people understood this. Later masses tend to elaborate in order to fill time and space. And that's why you so often find that in 17th, 18th, 19th century masses, the Benedictus, which we're going to hear from Monteverdi, is much longer than you'd expect. It's a very short text. It's frequently one of the longest pieces in a musical composition, because there's a lot going on, including the consecration up at the altar, and it's not going to be audible to the congregation, so they have to have something to listen to. One of the great, beautiful mistakes of church history. But now let's see what Monteverdi does with it in the 17th century. Thank you. Some of the problems about over-elaboration and non-liturgical proportion do go back, of course, before the Reformation. Certainly in England before the Reformation, the great masses of John Taverner, not the contemporary composer, obviously, but somebody who spells his name slightly differently, the great masses of John Taverner reflect a very strange approach to the Mass in which essentially everything is blanketed with music, music of incredible elaboration and beauty. But essentially you have about 10 minutes of the Gloria, 10 minutes for the Creed, 10 minutes for the Sanctus and Benedictus, and 10 minutes for the Agnus Dei. More or less equal sections of beautifully elaborate polyphony, simply tacked onto one another. The Kyrie was often sung just plain song. The Creed, I'm sorry to say, was sometimes abbreviated so that it didn't get too long, and you had those four movements of more or less equal length. Not surprisingly, after the Reformation, in both Catholic and Protestant church music in Britain, there was a bit of a reaction against that. When Marbeck produced his beautifully simple setting of the new English Eucharistic Rite, he followed Archbishop Cranmer's directive that you should have just one note for one word. Taverner was certainly the polar opposite of that. You can rather understand why Cranmer and others might have felt they were having too much of a good thing. But of course, liturgical music did not stop at the Reformation. It didn't stop in the newly independent Church of England. It didn't stop in the suppressed underground Roman Catholic presence in Britain either. In the Church of England, there was more focus on setting the great canticles of morning and evening prayer, and also setting short scriptural texts. Why would you do that? For exactly the reason that St. Augustine talks about in the 4th century. You set biblical texts so that you have a chance to hear the words of the Bible not just as words addressed to the mind, but as living words which draw you into another reality. It's the same familiar point. You're being invited into something larger and stranger, not just hearing the biblical text as a set of communications of ideas, but really as a word that seizes you and embraces you. So the anthems that come from the Reformed Church of England in the 16th and 17th century are another way of expressing that fundamental conviction that music in the liturgy is not decorative, not simply bolted on. It's part of what the liturgical action is most deeply about. I mentioned the underground life of the Roman Catholic Church in 16th and 17th century Britain also. And one of the most poignant things from that era is the church music written by Tallis and by William Byrd for the Roman Catholic liturgy. Music which they must have known would never be publicly performed in their own lifetimes, in their own context. The beautiful settings of the Mass, which Byrd wrote, the three-part, four-part, and five-part Masses, which, if I had to come clean, I'd say I think are the most perfect settings of the Eucharistic liturgy that I know, those might have been sung by little groups of recusant Catholics in the houses, perhaps when a priest just two steps ahead of the police would turn up to celebrate. And they have about them that intensity and focus of a community under persecution. But meanwhile, the established church continued to develop its own liturgical style, more and more elaborating the liturgy not of the Mass, but of the office. And the anthems that are mentioned in the Book of Common Prayer would have been, as I've said, musical meditations on great and mind-expanding texts. Henry Purcell in the late 17th century is by a long way the greatest composer of his era in Britain and one of the very greatest in Europe. And Purcell, who wrote a great deal for the Royal Chapels in London, certainly spared no resources in his setting of great texts from Scripture, psalms, passages from the Epistles of Paul. And we're going to listen to one of his best-known settings, Rejoice in the Lord Always, words taken from St. Paul's letter to the Philippians. And here we have an exuberant, varied, very nearly but not quite theatrical setting of that injunction to rejoice. Purcell can be much more theatrical than this. If any of you know his anthem, They That Go Down to the Sea in Ships, you know just how theatrical he can get when he really puts his mind to it. But he's still within that tradition, which sees the point of music as enlarging, illustrating, exploring, fleshing out a text that is there. So let's listen to Purcell's Rejoice in the Lord, the bell anthem, as it's sometimes called. Thank you. a scriptural text used, as many texts were in the Middle Ages, in a kind of statement and response, or versicle and response style, repetitions of a refrain, focusing again and again, and again I say rejoice, on the words, opening up a dimension to us in which the rejoicing of creation itself is something into which we are summoned. It's really in the 18th and 19th centuries that a deeper focus on stirring emotions takes over in a great deal of church music, and it's still with us today, especially in the world of popular praise songs and choruses. It's not nonsense. It's certainly not to be despised. But there is more to music in the liturgy than just satisfying emotion, whether it comes from a 19th century composer or a 20th century hymn writer. What I've been arguing briefly this evening is that the real point of music in the liturgy of the church is the point of liturgy itself, that we should come to live somewhere else, somewhere new. The newness of the world that God's grace in Christ opens to us should become something real in which we can participate here and now. You might like to think, as we end this event, of feelings this evening. Doubtless some feelings that you'd like to hear more of the choir and less of the speaker, because I'm so grateful to the choir for doing so wonderfully this evening. Thank you enormously. But think about how that music works on feeling. As I said earlier, my guess is that you won't react with an emotion that says, I feel happier or sadder because of that. But you might simply feel, I'm in a larger world. Something has opened up for me. And just like the chambers inside the skull with which I began, there's more space resonating in my heart and soul than I began with. That's what liturgy is meant to do. That's what music in the liturgy is meant to do. And for all Augustine's unease about it, it's still a reality. It still works. It still transforms. May it go on doing just that. Thank you for listening.